So this is basically how activist investing has been developing, right? So in it has become a positive force.
I think so. I think what's happened is, I think more and more activist investors are seeking board seats without having to pursue a public campaign first. Mm-hmm. Quietly going on the board, learning the business, developing a good relationship with management. Because in the end, the agency principal problem has existed since, you know, since Adam Smith identified it, whenever it was, around capitalism. The principle, the agency principle issue exists, right? There's nobody in that. There's very rarely a director that has bought stock with his own money, right? I mean, if you really trace the beginning of activist investing, it was the hostile LBO in the 1980s, really, to a certain extent, was the beginning of hostile investing. That was cut short by Marty Lipton, who put in the poison pill. And that allowed the management team to entrench themselves, because at that point, you, especially with the staggered board, you really couldn't go after the company. And so the CEO really was not held to market forces. Mm-hmm. He couldn't lose his company unless you went through him, which is when all the severance packages kicked in. And really, that's the source, to a certain extent, is the poison pill and staggered boards of excess compensation, in my opinion. And then the mutual funds got really big. You know, I was part of that. And they're very passive by definition. They're conflicted. They don't want to pick on board members because they might be able to get their 401k plan. And all that pendulum swung so far that you had Enron and WorldCom and the whole crew in 2000, where the board members were basically just completely asleep. And really, so that was a spark for the current wave. And I think it's, people have decided this is an asset class. There's value to be added by bringing a principal inside the public company boardroom where there really is no other principal. Maybe the CEO owns some stock, but you know, usually that's been given to him as well. And those members, those shareholder directors, bring a sense of urgency, a knowledge of the business, and a capital markets expertise that they've never had in the boardroom. I mean, most simply, you know, you get into a discussion around share repurchase and, you know, there's some real misconceptions. Oftentimes we're telling the board, this is what the shareholders want because we're one of them. And it's completely opposite of what they thought they wanted because they've never talked to a shareholder. You know, in the UK, the directors tend to interface more with shareholders. The chairman actually goes out and gets his independent view. In the US, traditionally, the directors are hearing what the shareholders want through the CEO, right? So anyways, there's a whole bunch of reasons why this should work, why it's needed, and why it can generate an excess return. But only recently are you starting to develop the sort of capital base, because you need longer term capital to pursue it. And the sort of participants, you know, that want to go inside the room with a long term focus and an operating focus. You're just now starting to get, I guess, a roster of folks that are doing that.
You need patient investors, right?
The problem is, as long as the capital in the public market stays short-term, monthly, quarterly, even annual liquidity, it's difficult for somebody to go into a boardroom with a three-year turnaround plan because they just don't know if their capital base is going to be there. So, you know, the quick twitch public campaign, you know, sell your company tomorrow, was they were attacking undervalued companies, you know, but they needed it to happen so quickly that I think it did everybody a disservice, you know. So when Carl says, you know, he buys Motorola and he says, buy back $10 billion of stock. Well, he didn't know that they were going to miss a product cycle or two and that they were going to lose money in cell phones. So 6 months later, he said, time out, you know, split up your company. But then the other company started to underperform as well, and so you can't really separate two underperforming companies. So it's a timeout. You know, you can't just keep going throwing stuff at the wall. You need to get in there, get the information, and work on a long-term plan that is, you know, is going to be sustainable, right?
Yeah, and have the capital and the investors.
Have the sort of investors and capital that give you the confidence you can get to the other side.
Yes.
There's a template to what we do,
yeah.
Right? Which is the public market There's a jewel business inside every company that we've bought, and it was probably their core franchise, and it's probably 20 years old, let's say, 30 years, 20, 30 years old. And it, for many, many years, it grew at a high rate and generated cash, and the management team looked really good because the value proposition was so powerful. You know, it tends to be businesses where you're a small part of your customer's cost structure, but you're a critical path, so you can price it, your product along its value rather than off its cost. Mm-hmm. And it's intellectual property-based businesses, so we do technology, software, healthcare products and services, and business services and information services, really only. That's all we do. But then what happens is a business matures, the stock price is reflecting previous growth that's probably hard to sustain, and the management team starts to panic, and they start buying stuff. And that creates two things. One, it's hard to create a lot of value when you buy stuff that's not directly related to your core franchise. And secondly, it distracts your team from the good business, from the core business, the jewel business. In almost every situation, what happens is we come in kind of 5 or 10 years into what has been an acquisition, plan to a certain extent, that was used to support an absolute growth rate, because the public market demands absolute growth. They ask every conference call, how fast are you going to grow? And, they do one too many of those, and the car hits the wall at 60 miles an hour. And the stock price by then has gone from 30 to 12, right? The ability to make money at 12 is really quite easy if you just kind of go back to the core business, which might be growing 6%. But if you get rid of all the other stuff, you start turning off loss makers. You get back to a core franchise that's generating cash in good times and bad and growing at 6 or 8%. And you almost by definition create tremendous value. Then you've got a business, by the way, that is pure play, and it's easily, it's got a strategic value again, rather than something that's been added onto and amalgamated. So almost in every case, we get involved, we get smaller by selling or divesting. Then we typically use the cash and buy back stock before the world's figured out, that this business is gonna get a lot better. And then, if everything works well, we've shrunk the shares, we've returned it to a pure play strategic value, and we sell it with a control premium attached to it. But almost in every case, whether it's our current investments, things like Mysis and Sara Lee and Valiant Pharmaceuticals, these are a lot, and Gartner, these are our biggest investments. The first move, once we get involved, is to get smaller, to sell a big part of the portfolio. Now, that a lot of times requires management change, because the CEO that bought this stuff, it's hard for him to turn around and immediately sell it. And, our discussion with the CEO is, look, we think we can add a lot of value. We've also accessed the board and the chairman, so, made sure that they're engaged and know us. We're accountable to our investors, just like you're accountable to the board. As long as you perform, we're going to love you and, make sure you get, the equity you deserve in this company. We're not like some of these public activist investors that complain about CEO compensation. If the guy performs, we want him to have a lot of stock. We want him to think and act like us. But if he doesn't perform, you're going to lose your job possibly. But, do you want to be held accountable for your performance or not? And sometimes they say no, and they bring in the general counsel, and then we say, okay, we'll move on. We have 5,000 stocks, and we only have to find 3 or 4 new ideas a year. So we're really not looking to pick fights. But we are looking for a board that wants to hold management accountable. And, that's a discussion before we get too deep.